Thank you. All right, why don't we stand together? We're going to just open in prayer. We're going to dig into the Word today. Father, we thank you for this time together, Lord. We thank you, Father, that your Word has the ability to transform us and change us and stretch us. And we welcome you, Holy Spirit. Give us ears to hear what the Spirit is saying today. In Jesus' name, and everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Look to your neighbor and say, you look good today.
Awesome.
If you're still single, that might work out for you, right? Always been a matchmaker. Well, this week we're talking about growing up. We're on our fourth part. This is the final episode. We're finished off today. And, you know, as you know, we had an anniversary last week. You may be seated if you want. Yeah. It's all right if you want to stand with me. That's awesome. But keep me company. But, so we had an anniversary last week. And before that, the week before, we had a speaker come in. But, so we're a few weeks off from the series, but we're going to finish it up today. And I want to start with our opening scripture here that we've been going over here. And this is in 1 John chapter 2, verse 12 to 14. John says, I write to you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write to you, fathers, because you've known him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you've overcome the wicked one. I write to you, little children, because you've known the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I've written to you, young men, because you're strong and the word of God abides in you and you have overcome the wicked one. And so we see in this passage of scripture, we see that there's three stages of spiritual development. We see it in the natural, but that same thing reflects in the spiritual. Okay, so we see these three stages. We see childhood, we see adolescence, and we see adulthood or maturity. So we see these three stages. And the reason why I'm doing this series is because We want to determine and understand where we are in our spiritual development, number one. But we also want to know how to interact with people without hurting them. We want to effectively help them grow in their faith. And we need to know where they are in this spectrum of development, okay? So this is kind of the reasons why I'm doing this series. In the first week, we talked about little children. So little children, okay, are dependent. How many know little children need mom and dad? They need a guardian to help them, right, to develop. And the reason why is because they're ignorant. They don't know that they don't know. And so they need parents to help them develop and learn to walk and learn to talk and learn manners. How many know we need to train our children because they're dependent on us even for safety? And they don't know that they don't know. You know, when I was little, I remember I was nine years old, and I was really badly constipated. I just was drinking too much milk, eating all the cheese, you know. And I was in a bad place, and I remember my mom coming in, and she opened up the pantry there in the bathroom, and there was this chocolate called Ex-Lax. She goes, this will help you, son. And so she broke off a tiny little piece and gave it to me, and it tasted good. It was sweet as chocolate, and my problems were fixed. Amen? No problem. But you see, I thought, you know, this would be really good to see how my brother reacts. So I had a younger brother. He's a few years younger. And so I said, hey, I got a chocolate bar for you. And I gave him this whole chocolate thing. Thanks, Travis. And he ate the whole thing. See, I didn't know that was going to cause a problem. But, you know, I'm talking like 2 days in the bathroom. It was horrible. Right? I was disciplined really bad for that. But you see, my parents should have had a lock on that cabinet. So the point is, that's my childhood, always getting in trouble, right? But the thing is, there's a need to gain knowledge as a child. You need to learn. You need to develop. You need to understand certain things are right, certain things are wrong. There's this whole learning. It's all about gaining knowledge. And we talked about that in our first week. The second week, we talked about a spiritual growth, the area of adolescent. And as an adolescent, that's a time when you're beginning to develop, and the next point here is you become independent. You want to be independent. When you're a child, your mom and dad are like superheroes, they're Marvel characters, they can do anything, right? You just, he can beat up your dad. You know, like, there's all of this, you know, looking to mom and dad, but at the end of the day, as we get older, we want to be independent. We want to spread our own wings. We want to become our own person, and we want to develop. And sometimes that's called a stage, it's kind of a stage of exploration or a rebellious stage in some cases, right? But it's all about self-focus, okay? And this is the stage that we go through in the natural, but also in the spiritual, right? And this is a time where you know that you know, I know I'm right. You know, I had my kids say, Dad, we're not living in the 80s anymore, you know? That's not right, you know? And there's just an attitude of like, I've gained knowledge and now I know everything, right? I kind of came out of Bible school and, you know, 2 years of sitting under the Word for 8 hours a day, and I come out and I think I know everything. And I want to debate and argue with all the doctrine and theology and became a bit of a debater. And, you know, I love that, right? Because I was finding my identity. But as I've gotten older, I realize I don't really know as much as I think I know. I begin to realize that God is like a diamond, you know? These multi-faced diamonds, and you turn them, and every time you turn the diamond, you get a light glimmering off another faucet of that diamond. And that's how God is. He's so amazing. So you get to the place as an adult, as you mature, we'll go to the next one, and this was the last week I talked, was the stage of being a father. Being a mother and father is that stage where now you're no longer independent, you're dependable, right? And you're in a stage where you're helping, you want to serve, you're not thinking about what's in it for you, you're thinking about the next generation, you're thinking about your kids' future, you're thinking about their college, you're thinking about others. And now you don't know everything, now you're at a place where you know the one who knows, and that's called wisdom, right? Wisdom is a proper application of knowledge. So we have all this knowledge, but as we mature, we have to learn how to apply that knowledge so we don't kill people, right? Because I've been in churches where a pastor says something and it's just like half the church leaves because it wasn't said in the right spirit. How many hear what I'm saying? There has to be wisdom that moves us into the next realm of development. How many hear what I'm saying? Okay? So the adolescent stage is about becoming independent, finding your own identity. It's all your self-focus idea. But every age of, or every stage of development is good. It's necessary as a foundation for the next stage. So we need to know, like as little children, the Bible, John says, little children, you have known the Father. In other words, you have a relationship with the Father. Young men, you have overcome the wicked one because the Word of God abides in you. Now you can stand up and you can fight your own battles. Amen. You don't need your pastor to pray with you because now you know who you are in Christ. Yes. And you can overcome yourself. And then there's the next stage where we become servants and we serve others as mothers and fathers. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3 to 5 tells us, don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourself. I remember as a teenager, I was always trying to impress others, right? But we got to mature and get to that place where we're not thinking better of ourselves than others. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others also, right? And there comes a time in our spiritual development that we move away from independence and we become interdependent. In other words, you realize that like it's not just about my gifts and talents and abilities. I need Pastor Peter. He has a gift mix that actually I need, right? I need his Shelley and Dave. How many know I like to worship? I can't preach and lead worship, right? I need them. They need me. We need one another. We all have a part to play in the body. We're interdependent. We work together as a body. And when we do that, we become dependable for God.
Amen.
Amen. And that's the stage that God wants to move his church to, a place of where we are dependable for one another and for God. And we're told here what attitude we're supposed to have in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 9. It says, you must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. In other words, Jesus wasn't looking, he wasn't like walking in and going, put out the red carpet, I'm the man of God for the hour, and I'm prophet so-and-so. He didn't have that attitude. He didn't look to be praised. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took on the humble position of a slave. How many of you are parents? Let me see your hands. Welcome to slavery. Seriously, like if you think about it, I think about my children, like the moment you have kids, man, you're a slave to that, because now you got to go to work to make money to pay for their hockey and to pay for their education in the future, to feed them, and they eat a lot, especially in their teenage years, right? And it's like you become a slave, but it's not a burden because of your love for your children. Right? You just do it. It's natural. It's the same way in the kingdom of God. We get to a place where God is calling us up to be fathers and mothers in the faith to raise up sons and daughters. And we become slaves. In other words, we're here to serve. We're here to take care of. We're here to minister to. It's not only about our own needs, but the needs of others. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took up the humble position of a slave. How are fathers and mothers dependable? We talked about this a few weeks ago. They'd rather serve than be served. Right? Like, I'm at a place in my life where I really do enjoy a good conference. I like to listen to good preaching, good teachers. I like to worship. I like to receive. How many know it's okay to receive? But I actually prefer to serve. It's funny, we go to visit churches sometime. We were at a church, my wife and I were visiting a church, and it was a portable church, and they started stacking chairs. And I didn't even I'm just stacking chairs and everything. But they're like, aren't you new? Yeah, no, I don't. I love doing this. I want to serve. How can I help? And it becomes a part of who you are, right?
Yeah.
When you're a spiritual mother and father, you'd rather serve than be served. They'd rather give than receive. I enjoy receiving, but I'd rather give. Their focus is on the development of others, and their willingness is there to make sacrifices. And when we have children, guess what? We're always making sacrifices, and we do it with joy, right? You know, I was talking in the first service about Bill here, our worship director. Isn't he doing a great job? You guys, he's doing a great job. But he lives out in the Sterling area, so he has to come in. He has to be up early in the morning, be here by 7 o'clock to get everything set up for the worship. And that's a sacrifice that he makes, and he does it joyfully because he wants to serve. But how many know when we serve, we have to make sacrifices? Amen? And that's a sign of being a mother or father. And it says that Jesus was born a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on the cross. And so, number one, he was obedient to God and he died. Say, he died.
Amen.
You know, and what happened when he died? To his own will and said, God, not my will, but your will, Father. And he went to the cross. What happened was God lifted him up and gave him a name above every other name. You know, that principle works. You know, we started this church in 2002 with my mother and father. And after 2 years, we felt God was calling us to Kingston. That's all we knew. We were to go there to be part of church planting. So we packed up and we left. And I spent 2 years in Kingston working odd jobs and trying to get by, not hardly making enough money. And then in the evening, I was trying to plant the church. I had three little kids. And we're working, and it was sacrifice, blood, sweat, and tears. And after 2 years, we had 20 members, and I was tired. And then I was invited to do a preaching circuit in Kingston through the different churches to help out with some evangelism, and I was doing that. And people were starting to recognize me and talk, and suddenly people were starting to come to the church, and it was starting to grow. And I was like, finally, after 2 years, we're seeing some fruit. And God spoke to me. He said, Travis, I want you to shut this down. I want you to go and be an assistant pastor for Cameron, another pastor in town who's starting a church. I was like, get behind me, Satan. Like, I thought it was the devil. Like, I was like, and then God said, no, I want you to do this, and it wouldn't leave me. And so I resisted it. I'm not going to, this can't be God. I've worked so hard to build this thing, and we're finally getting momentum. Why would God want to, you know, take this away? And I was really bothered by it. And so we went to a conference in Kingston. There was a worship conference. And so we were shutting our eyes. And I was worshiping Jesus. Every time I shut my eyes, I saw Cameron's face. I said, oh, man, this is weird. Like, I don't want to see him, you know. And every time I shut my eyes, there was his face right there. And I'm like, oh, God, okay, fine. So I talked to my wife about it. And finally I said, you know what, Lord? Not my will, but your will be done. I'll shut down the church. I'll have a meeting with our few members. And let them know we're going to help this other church. And so we made that decision, and we died. Because the Bible says unless a seed falls in the ground and dies, it remains alone. And, you know, it was very interesting because I had been there for 2 years, and I got, even though my church wasn't big, I got to know a lot of people. And so suddenly I'm over at this other church, a phone starts ringing off the hook. So all these people in the community, you know this Cameron Jefferson, have you heard of Impact Church? I'm like, yeah, actually I'm the assistant pastor now. They're like, are they good people? I said, you can trust them, they're excellent people. And the opening night, we had over 100 people. Because, and God says, I've used you, just like John the Baptist, to prepare the way for Jesus. I was preparing the way for this new church plan.
Yes.
Amen? But I wanted to do it my way. And the amazing thing, the Bible says, when Jesus humbled himself to the point of death, the criminal's death on the cross, that God elevated him and gave him a name. And the moment I did that, something very interesting happened. Suddenly, I got a phone call and I was introduced into a system where I was able to start a business and get money from the federal government to pay my salary for 1 year for me to start a business in Kingston. Isn't that awesome? So I started a business, and within a month, I was making double what I ever made for income. I doubled my income. I was able to sell my 1,400 square foot and buy a close to 3,000 square foot home with three big garages to run my business, and money started flowing in, and connections started flowing in. People were like, how are you in your first month of business making money that takes years from, how did you do? I don't know, I died. And the moment I just died, said, not my will, then God was able to lift me up. And as when we move from that place of adolescence to spiritual maturity, God's going to require us to die to something in our lives and do something that's going to cost us something. It's called sacrifice. And when we do that, then God is able to come in and lift us up and give us a name that is above the name that we had in the past. Amen? Because he's faithful. That's how God works. All right? And so, in Ephesians chapter 4, let's keep moving here. You guys want a few more verses?
Bring it.
Bring it. Okay, here we go. Jesus is talking about, or Paul is talking about, the fivefold ministry, and he says they're a gift to the body of Christ, and this is what he's explaining in verse 14, that the fivefold ministry will help people. And then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed, blown about by every wind of new teaching. Mm-hmm. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever that it sounds like the truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body. Right? Jesus is the head of the body. Mm-hmm. The church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. Each one does its own special work. It helps the other parts to grow.
Amen.
So that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of what?
Love.
Love. Every one of us, we do our part. You know, your hand has a function, your arm, your elbow, your leg. Like, every part of your physical body has a function. And Jesus is the head of the church. And this is what amazed me. I brought this hat along with me. It's my wife's. She's a hairdresser, so we have a bunch of these kicking around. And this is a modern-day Jesus, shaven, Caucasian, you know, just. And this guy, Jesus, is the head of the church. And together, all of us, and churches around this country and around the world, we make up the body of Christ in the earth. But it's important to understand, Jesus is the head, so all the knowledge, all the wisdom, all the spiritual sight, vision, the spoken word, everything comes from the head. And a body without a head is dead.
That's right.
Pretty simple, right? And so if you sever the head from the body can't go anywhere.
Can't function.
Yeah. Can't function. Can't move. But I want to say, in the same way, if you sever the head from the body, the head can't get anywhere either. So if the head is sitting in heaven and we are the body and we're refusing to bring the wisdom of God to the world, the vision of God to the world, the word of the Lord into the world, if we don't carry the head of Christ, then guess what? Jesus can't fulfill what he wants to fulfill in the earth. Because just like the body can't work without the head can't work without the body. And God has set it up in such a way that we are called to be the body. If you don't evangelize and you don't share your faith, if you don't serve, guess what? Jesus isn't able to do that because he works through us. Right? It says in Romans 10, 14 and 15, how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they have never heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent? That is why the scripture says, how beautiful are the feet of the messengers who bring the good news. And so, we can't just bring the head with us to church on Sunday, you know. We're worshiping, hallelujah. You know, we're singing songs, Jesus, good song. Yeah, Jesus, like, I like that song, it's about me. And you're worshiping, and you got Jesus with you, right? But then you go home, and, you know, you kind of, I'm going out tonight, I'm going to leave the head at home, and I'm just going to go and do what I want to do. I had to sit and watch a movie, and Jesus is with you, and he's like, I'm not interested in that, and he kind of turns around, right? Like, are we walking in relationship with the head? And as we spiritually mature, we understand that God has a part for everyone. And together, we're working together under the headship of Christ.
Amen.
To bring change in the world. Right? If Jesus wants to feed people in Trenton, it's Jesus' vision. So I want to feed people in Trenton that need food. And every church says, we're not interested. Guess what? Jesus can't feed people in Trenton. Because we are in partnership with Jesus.
Right.
But people don't like that. But God is sovereign. God does what he wants. No, he needs us. That's why there's a judgment day. We're going to be judged whether or not we did what we did. We help him or not. Right? And so God is calling us to understand that we're part of the body. So let's go back to our thing here. So the spiritual adolescent is nourished by receiving. Say, by receiving. Okay. The spiritual mature is nourished by serving God. Say that. The spirit mature is nourished by serving God and others. And so there's a difference. Okay. We receive spiritual nourishment through Bible teaching, by praise and worship, by prayer. When I pray and when I worship, I feel spiritually nourished. But guess what? There's a fourth food group, spiritual food group. And we read about this in John chapter 4, verse 30 to 33. And then they all went out to the city and came to Jesus. In the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi, eat something. But he said to them, I have food to eat which you do not know of. Therefore, the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him something to eat? And John chapter 4, verse 34 says, and Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. You know, I know I've told this story before. I remember, I had finished Bible school and I was a youth pastor and I was doing, you know, working in the church. And I got into a season of dryness of soul. Has anyone been to a place of dryness? You just kind of feel like, where's God?
Yes.
And I was like, I don't know what to do. So I began to play worship music, and I'd worship, and then I would have extended prayer. I'd pray for an hour a day, and then I would fast. I went into a five-day fast. I'm going to get, you know, I need spiritual nourishment. I just feel so dry. And the Lord spoke to me, and he said, I've been asking you to talk to your neighbor. Just talk to your neighbor for like 2 months, and you're not doing it. And so finally I said, okay, Lord. So I went and sparked up a conversation, shared a bit of my testimony, and immediately it was like spiritual nourishment. Just the presence of God returned. And part of our spiritual nourishment is that we're doing the work that he called us to do. How many know that?
Amen.
And we're all called to do something, right?
Yeah.
And he says, therefore, Jesus said, do not say there's still 4 months and then comes the harvest. Behold, I say to you, lift your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for harvest. I'm telling you right now, the fields for harvest in Trenton are ripe. Amen.
Amen.
Just this week, I led two people to the Lord. Just last Tuesday, you had two people get saved. People are getting saved. People are coming and they're hungry and they want to know the truth. Why?
Amen.
Because it's harvest time.
Yes.
Amen. And during this harvest time, it's important to know this, that 10% or 20% of the church cannot contain what God would like to do in this region. We just can't. It's not going to happen. Like just a small group of people saying, you know, we're going to get involved and we're going to plow. It's not going to happen. Because there's such a harvest that's coming in that if we as God's people say, you know what? I want to be a mother and a father. I'd rather serve than be served. I'd rather give than receive. I want, Lord, you to make that transition in my heart. As we make that transition in our hearts, I believe the harvest will open up and the harvest fields will come in.
Amen.
I believe that. Amen. And I'm so thankful to be part of a church that so many people, so many of you serve and you give of your time. And I'm so grateful for that. Here in this next slide, there's three levels of engagement. Number one is you can be an attender. And that's great. If you're coming to church and you're just attending, maybe you're new to faith, when you're coming to church and you just want to receive, you're in a season of receiving, that's okay. But maybe God's calling you up to the next point. The next stage is this, to be a contributor. He's saying, I want you to give of your time, your talent, your finances. I want you to sow. I want you to be involved. You can contribute by standing at the door and shaking people's hands, by sitting at the welcome table and welcoming new people. You could work in the kitchen. You can do things on your own at home. You can go and shovel the driveway for your neighbor in the winter and pray for them. I mean, I want to be a contributor to what God is doing. Then the third level is this, to be a group leader and to give spiritual care. Back in 2015, we decided, and I understood as I studied about church growth, that a pastor cannot be involved with everyone's spiritual development on a personal level. It just can't happen. And so we had decided back in 2015, we were going to start this thing called Connect Groups, so that people can go from our congregations and meet together and connect spiritually, so that if there's pastoral care issues, they can be dealt with at that level. See, the thing is, when you come here and you listen to me preach, or Peter, whoever's preaching, we're sitting in straight lines, and it's one-way communication. But when we sit in circles, we're ministering to one another. And we need to disciple one another. We have to be there for one another in circles, so we're discipling one another, and we're there for one another. That's why it's so important that you're part of a connect group. And maybe God is calling you and saying, you know what, it's time that you have a connect group in your home. You've been saved for 20 years, and I have something that you need to pour into someone's life. Maybe God is speaking to you and saying, you need to go to a connect group, or you need to be part of serving in this capacity. You know, there's opportunity right now. We need people in the kids ministry upstairs to serve. We need preteen workers. We need youth workers. We need all kinds of work. And God is calling us as mothers and fathers to say, how can I serve? How can I pour into someone else's life? Amen? And that's what God is calling us to do. And so let's bring up our last slide here. I want to just summarize this whole series that we did. So little children are dependent. The adolescent is independent. And the adult is dependable. The little children are ignorant. They don't know much. The adolescent gains knowledge. In adulthood, you have wisdom, which is the application of knowledge. Little children are underdeveloped. Adolescent are developing their self. Adults are developing others. Little children have a lot of weaknesses. They need protection, right, from their parents. But as an adolescent, there's strength that you develop. As an adult, you get meekness, which is strength under control, right? You're not just lashing out, but you have control. Little children are always receiving. Adolescents are achieving, and adulthood, we're giving. Little children are trying to figure out who Christ is, right? Understanding Jesus. The adolescent is understanding who they are in Christ, the authority. They're growing in their development. And as adults, we die to self. We pick up our cross, and we follow Christ. And it doesn't matter where you are in this stage of development. God is always calling us up to the next level. Amen? And we never stop growing. We're always developing from glory to glory until we see Him, right? And so this is a question. Lord, where are we, if we're to be honest with ourselves, in our spiritual development? And how are you calling me to serve? How are you calling me up? Let's stand and we're going to pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Father, we thank you, God, that you're calling us as your children. You love us so much. Your word says, you know, that our fathers loved us and they disciplined us because they loved us. And how much more will you discipline us because you're our Father in heaven. And God, I thank you, Lord, that you're calling us to a place of growth. Father, thank you, Lord, right now that you're speaking to us, those of us who have been attenders, and God, you're saying it's time to step up and to begin to contribute in a new level and to be challenged to give at the next level. Some of us are contributors, and you're saying, God, I want you to step up and be a group leader and be responsible for people spiritually and to pray and be available to pour into people. God, you're calling us to grow up. You're calling us to the next level of development. And we're excited because you're with us. Father, I pray that you'd speak to everyone's heart as we close off this morning. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We have just a little announcement here. Please announce sandwiches for treats after service. And we also need a few people to assist with setting up the chairs over here, I think. But God is good. Amen?
Amen.
How many has God spoken to anyone in this series? Can I see your hands? God has just really spoken to you about moving up into the next level. Amen? Well, God bless you guys and have a great week.
Hey, you didn't put the crumble.